I welcome you all for today's online class on Vibrio cholerae. Let me start with a brief history of this disease. Cholera is an ancient disease. It is present on this earth since several centuries. It is not known exactly where it has originated, but it is thought to have originated somewhere in the Indian continent, Indian subcontinent, mostly along the Brahmaputra Delta region, the place where today we have the West Bengal or the Bangladesh. Somewhere in this region it might have originated. Since the recorded history, that means since the time we know we have recorded our history, there have been 7 pandemics of cholera. The first cholera pandemic occurred in the Bengal region near Calcutta. That was in 1817 and lasted till 1824. During this pandemic, it spread to several countries in Southeast Asia, the Middle East, Europe, and Eastern Africa. The second pandemic started from 1826 and lasted till 1837. And it particularly affected North America and Europe. The third pandemic erupted in 1846 and it lasted till 1860. Here it extended to North Africa and reached even South America. The fourth pandemic started in 1863 and lasted until 1875. So this had spread from India to Naples, which is in Italy, and Spain. The fifth pandemic started in 1881 and lasted until 1896. So this started in India and once again spread to Europe, Asia, and South America. The sixth pandemic started in 1899 and lasted until 1923. And it affected many countries, but the severely affected countries were Egypt, the Arabian Peninsula, Persia, which is now Iran, India, and the Philippines. And the most recent pandemic one, that is the seventh pandemic, originated in 1961 in Thailand, Indonesia. In the 19th century, cholera claimed tens of millions of people's lives. You can imagine how severe the disease was. Around 1 million people died in Russia alone. If you look at the data from India, between 1900 and 1920, this was the time when India was under British occupation, around 8 million people died of cholera. Numbers could have been more, we don't know, but 8 million is the approximate numbers. This bacterium was discovered in 1854 by an Italian anatomist, Filippo Pacini. 1854, the bacterium was discovered, but it took at least a decade more for people to realize that it is this bacterium which was causing cholera. Even after discovery, it took a lot of time for the science to relate this bacterium with cholera. 1892 was a time when Russian bacteriologist Waldemar Hafkin developed the first cholera vaccine. Here I would like to recall an interesting incident. This was during the third pandemic when England was also affected. In 1854, there was an outbreak in a region surrounding the Broad Street, which is also known as the Golden Square. During this pandemic, around 616 people died. At this time, it was not known that it is the contaminated water that was infective. Dr. John Snow, he thought that perhaps a well from which the water was being drawn was contaminated. So on the right side, what you see is the picture of this hand pump, which was drawing water from a well. He thought that it is this water which is causing the infection, and therefore what he did was he just removed the handle of this pump. And then the cholera cases diminished. So he proved that it was the infected water which was causing cholera. And then it was only in 1883 that cholera, Vibrio cholerae, was found to be the pathogen causing cholera. So the organism was isolated in 1854, but its association with cholera was in 1883. Here I would like to mention two contributions from Indians, which are not so popular. 1953, a Bengali scientist, Hemendranath Chatterjee, he formulated the oral rehydration salt or oral rehydration solution, which was found to be an effective treatment for cholera. Second important contribution from an Indian was in 1959, Dr. Shambhunath Day. It was him who discovered that it is the toxin that is produced by Vibrio cholerae that is responsible for the diarrhea by formulating a rabbit ileal loop model method. So it is very unfortunate that this person did not get the right kind of recognition that he should have got. He was nominated to the Nobel Prize also, but his bad luck, he never got the Nobel Prize for such an important discovery of that time. Now, let's see how severe cholera is. There is no doubt that cholera used to be pandemics some time ago, but fortunately, since 1961, there hasn't been any other pandemic, although there are outbreaks going on here and there. So WHO estimates that there are somewhere between 1.3 to 4 million cases of cholera worldwide, and up to 1,43,000 people die of this disease every year. The latest data from 2016, collected by WHO, states that 54% of these cases are from Africa, 13% of them are from Asia, and 32% of them are from Caribbean. Cholera, even though is not that feared now, it is still endemic in many countries. Now, if you look at the picture of India here, on the right you see the Indian map. 19 districts in India, out of total 685 districts, are endemic to cholera. So which are these districts or union territories? Chandigarh, West Bengal, Kerala, Karnataka, Gujarat, Punjab, Haryana. And these are the cities or districts in these states where cholera is still endemic. Now, why should we know about this? Why should we study where the disease is endemic? For two reasons. One, if you are visiting that place or planning to visit that place, you should be aware of the diseases present in that place. Or two, if any visitor is coming from such places where certain diseases are endemic, they must be screened, or else they will be transferring the disease to the country they are visiting. This is why the knowledge of the disease is, according to the geography, is important. This is the 2010 to 2015 data. As you can see, that it is still being reported in India. 2015 data, it is still reported from India. Now let us see how is this disease transmitted and what is its cycle. It's a beautiful graphical representation here. What does this show here? This is the water. What kind of water is it? It's a warm, salt or fresh water environment, brackish or estuarian, that is where the river meets the ocean. In such places, Vibrio cholerae is known to thrive. When such water is consumed, infected water, contaminated water is consumed, the bacterium colonizes the small intestine of the person, and now the person develops severe diarrhea. So individuals fall ill with secretory diarrhea, shedding voluminous amounts of stool. And when such fecal material is then contaminating the water bodies once again, and then such infected water is contaminated water is consumed by healthy people, they fall sick, and this is how the cycle continues. Treatment, ORS. Now let us examine the pathogenesis. Cholera is caused by Vibrio cholerae. Now what we should know here is that Vibrio cholerae has many serogroups. I'll tell you what serogroups are later, but for now just know that only two serogroups are important. They are O1 and O139. Vibrio cholerae serogroup O1, Vibrio cholerae serogroup O139. Vibrio cholerae O139 is more recent. It was identified in actually Vellore in Tamil Nadu. Some people say it was in Bangladesh, so there is a small controversy here. It has not been identified outside Asia. So it has spread from here, but not gone to other countries. So that is why it is not a pandemic. I mean, it has not gone across several continents. If you look at the type of the disease caused by O1 or O139, they're same. So there is no difference in the illness caused by these zero groups. So how do we define cholera? Cholera is an acute diarrheal infection. It is actually gastroenteritis because there is both vomiting and diarrhea, which is caused by the ingestion of food or water that is contaminated with the bacterium Vibrio cholerae. So what is cholera? Cholera is a diarrheal infection or gastroenteritis, which is caused by the ingestion of food or water, which is contaminated with the bacterium Vibrio cholerae. The incubation period can be as short as 12 hours, can be as long as 5 days. Which age group does it affect? It can affect any age group, children and adults equally. Is it lethal? Yes. In severe cases, it can kill within hours if the patient is not treated. Now, the good thing about cholera is that most infected people are asymptomatic. Kindly excuse me here. This is asymptomatic. These asymptomatic, which could be up to 75% of cases, are asymptomatic. They don't suffer from diarrhea, but they continue to shed the bacterium in the feces for 1 to 10 days after getting infected. Now, these people are the ones who are shedding the bacteria and contaminating the environment, but they themselves are not aware of it. Now, if you look at the symptomatic people who are around 25% of the cases, even among them, not everybody suffers from severe disease. The majority of them have only mild or moderate symptoms. It is only the minority of people who develop acute watery diarrhea with severe dehydration. So we know that this is not that severe under present circumstances. In the past, it used to be a severe disease. Now, what is the infective dose? How many bacteria are required to initiate the disease? The infective dose is around 10 raised to 8 bacilli. Now, why is this such large number? If you might recall, for Shigella, the infective dose is less, around 10 raised to 2. But here, it is 10 raised to 8. Why is this so? Because this bacteria is susceptible to gastric acidity. Therefore, a large number of bacteria is required that at least some of them will survive and go into the small intestine. Therefore, those conditions which lower gastric acidity, for example, person is suffering from hypochlorhydria or achlorhydria or is taking antacids, in such conditions, they are more likely to develop the disease. Now, which part of the intestine does it affect? It affects the small intestine. So once the bacteria are ingested with food or water, they survive the gastric acidity and reach the small intestine. Now here, I would like to state one more thing. It is believed that in countries with poor hygiene or developing countries. Here, the infection is mostly transmitted through water. Whereas in developed countries, where levels of hygiene are thought to be better, there it is often caused by eating contaminated food. Now, what kind of food would that be? Now, assume that bacteria are shed in the feces, which get into the water bodies, and now they are taken up or get attached to the planktons which are present in the water, and these planktons are then consumed by mollusks such as oysters. And when people consume such food, seafoods, without cooking them properly, the bacteria goes into the system. So this is the difference between the mode of infection among underdeveloped and developed countries. Okay, now I'll come back to the pathogenesis. Once the bacterium is ingested and comes to the small intestine, it penetrates the mucosa. It is believed that the motility of the bacterium, which has a single polar flagellum, so therefore it's highly motile, and the presence of mucinase enzyme helps it to cross the mucosa and reach the epithelial cells of the small intestine. There, with the help of its fimbriae, it is able to attach to the epithelial cell. Now, this fimbriae is also known as TCP, which stands for toxin co-regulated pyrene. It means it is the same gene which codes for both the cholera toxin as well as this pyrene. Now, there is another aspect of this pyrene. It is that it also happens to be the point of infection for a bacteriophage. That means Vibrio cholerae is infected by bacteriophage, and this bacteriophage binds to pyrene and then initiates the infection of the bacterium. I'll talk about that a little later. Now, let's look at the toxin. The cholera toxin is a protein. So therefore, the gene for cholera toxin is encoded on a phage-derived pathogenicity island. What does this mean? What is a pathogenicity island? Pathogenicity island means a stretch of DNA on the chromosome, which holds clusters of other genes which are coding for various virulence factors. And now in this case, it is derived from a phage. That means the gene coding for cholera toxin is actually found on a bacteriophage. When this bacteriophage infects Vibrio cholerae, this gene now gets inside the chromosome and becomes a part of the chromosome. This is the source of the cholera toxin. Okay, now let us have a look at the toxin. The cholera toxin is basically an exotoxin. It is also an enterotoxin. So enterotoxin is an exotoxin acting on the intestine. It is made up of two fragments, A and B. Easy to remember, B for binding, A for active. The fragment B binds to ganglioside receptor, which is present on the exterior of the epithelial cells of the intestine. So B binds to the ganglioside receptor on the epithelial cell and helps to internalize the fragment A. So B remains outside, A comes inside the cell, inside the enterocyte. Once inside, the fragment A is further cleaved into A1 and A2. Here A1 is active. What does A1 do? It causes the ADP ribosylation of G protein. So G protein is basically a switch. It is ribosylated, which activates adenylate cyclase. As a result of activation of adenylate cyclase, there is an increased accumulation of cyclic AMP inside the cell. Now, what is the effect of increased levels of cyclic AMP inside the cell? This inhibits absorption of sodium and promotes excretion of chloride. So, sodium doesn't get inside anymore, and chlorine is going out of the cell into the lumen. Along with the chlorine also goes out hypochlorite. Now, what is happening here? There is increased solute concentration in the lumen. Therefore, water flows outside from the cell into the lumen in order to maintain the osmolality. So this causes accumulation of fluid in the intestine, and this is responsible for the diarrhea. So basically, the fluid that accumulates in the lumen of intestine is isotonic fluid, just the body fluid. Look at this picture here. This is the bacterium, releases cholera toxin, binds to the ganglia receptor, B stays outside, A comes inside, A is split into A1 and A2. A1 stimulates the G protein, adenylate cyclase, increased cyclic AMP production, and the sodium is no longer absorbed. Chloride is sent outside in order to match the osmolality. The water from inside the cell will also flow out. Now let us look at the clinical presentation in the patient. The onset is usually sudden and it manifests as watery diarrhea. Over a course of period, it becomes voluminous. Now, how is the stool described? The stool is described as rice watery. Why? Because the feces is water in consistency, have plenty of mucus flakes in it. It resembles the water in which the rice has been washed. That is why it is called rice watery. It has a fishy and a non-offensive odor. In some patients, there may be vomiting. So vomiting may or may not be there. And patients are generally afebrile. So fever is generally not seen in cholera. The biggest problem with cholera is the loss of body fluids. What does it lead to? It can lead to hypovolemic shock, because when a lot of body water is lost in feces, it leads to hypovolemic shock and acidosis. Why acidosis? Because of loss of bicarbonate. Electrolyte imbalance. When the body is losing both electrolytes and water, this electrolyte imbalance may lead to muscle cramps. Excessive fluid loss will also lead to loss of body weight. Here, in patients with body loss of 5 to 10%, we'll have following presentations. Orthostatic hypotension. This is also known as postural hypotension. That is when they try to stand up from a supine position, they feel giddy. Weakness, tachycardia, decreased skin turgor. They are thirsty and they are eager to drink. Now, when the body weight loss is more than 10%, the patients are unable to drink. There is oliguria. It can lead to renal failure. The pulse is weak. Eyes are sunken and skin become wrinkled. This is also known as the washerwoman's hand. I'll show you the picture later. And the patient can go into coma. So this is a picture of a patient with acute or severe diarrhea. So this is called the washerwoman's hands, and as you can see, the wrinkling of the skin. So this is because of the loss of skin turgor, loss of body fluids. So this is a picture of a hospital in Bangladesh. So what I wanted to show here is the bed, specially made for cholera cases, wherein there is an opening in the center and it is covered in plastic sheets, and there's a bucket or a bin placed below this one, so that the feces will go directly into the bin. So this is another picture of a cholera bed, where there is a hole in the between and a tub or a bin is placed so that the feces directly falls into the bin here. So this is a picture of the stool in a container, rice watery stool. This is how it looks like. Now let me briefly tell you about the bacterium, Vibrio cholerae. Vibrio cholerae is a gram-negative, slightly curved bacilli belonging to the family Vibrionaceae. Because the bacterium is slightly curved, this was previously known as comma bacilli, because comma is slightly curved. So comma bacilli, this was the old name given to this bacterium. Now, based on the surface antigens, Vibrio cholerae is divided into serogroups. So there are more than 140 serogroups. Of them, two are important, O1 and O139. So this is based on the somatic O antigen, O1 and O139. All the remaining ones, from O2 to O138 and O140 onwards, all of these are called NAG vibrios or non-cholera vibrios. NAG, N-A-G, NAG stands for non-agglutinable. That means they do not agglutinate with antisera for either O1 or O139. And since these do not cause cholera, they were called non-cholera vibrios. Anyway, both of these nomenclatures are no longer used. Non-cholera vibrios or non-agglutinable vibrios are no longer used. Now, a little bit about this O139 strain. As I already mentioned, it was discovered, it was isolated in 1992 from Vellore, somewhere near Chennai. From there, it has spread to Bengal, Bangladesh, where it caused more severe cholera. So therefore, it is more popularly known as the Bengal strain. Now, it is differing from O1 in that O139 is capsulated. It has a capsule. And because it is capsulated, it is also invasive. Therefore, it can cause bacteremia and extra intestinal infections. O139, although it was originated from India, it spread to 11 countries within the Asia, and it fell short of starting the 8th pandemic. So far, we have only 7 pandemics. This had the potential to create an 8th pandemic, but fortunately, that did not happen. Now, coming back to this serogroup O1. So I told you that the two important serogroups are O1 and O139. O139 is more recent. Serogroup O1 is further divided into biotypes and serotypes. You must know this. The two important biotypes are classical biotype and LTOR biotype. It is called LTOR because this was discovered in the LTOR area. It was a quarantine camp in the Egypt. That is why it is called LTOR. So there are two biotypes. What do you mean by biotypes? Biotype means you classify or differentiate the strains based on their some biochemical tests or biochemical properties. So we have two biotypes here, classical and LTOR. Now the O1 also has three serotypes. They are Ogawa, Inaba, and Hikojima. Ogawa has antigens A and B, Inaba has antigens A and C, and Hikojima has all the three, A, B, and C. So these are the three serotypes and these are the two biotypes. Now why should we know about this? It is not essential in the diagnosis of cases, but it is useful for epidemiological studies. So generally for individual cases, we don't go up to the identification of biotype or serotype. But if epidemiological studies are required, then you must know which serotype or which biotype is responsible for the outbreak. Now, this is one question that is often asked either in Viva or in exam, is what are the differences between LTOR and classical strains? So these are the differences. These are the properties here and these are the differences here. Beta hemolysis on sheep blood agar, classical negative, LTOR positive. Agglutination of chick RBC, classical does not agglutinate, whereas LTOR agglutinates. Vogt's Proskauer test, classical is negative, LTOR is positive. CAMP test, we know CAMP test is done for group B, streptococcus, it can be done here also. Classical is negative, whereas LTOR is positive. Now, polymyxin B susceptibility test. So we are using a filter paper disc containing 50 units of polymyxin B. Classical strains or classical biotype are susceptible, whereas LTOR is resistant. Now, Vibrio cholerae is susceptible to certain bacteriophages. We have what? Group 4 phage and group 5 phage. Classical strains are susceptible to group 4, whereas LTOR are resistant. Group 5 phage, classical is resistant, whereas LTOR is susceptible. If you look at this cholera gene, cholera toxin gene, the classical one is CTX1 gene, whereas LTOR is CTX2 gene. Now, what is the importance of these two strains? I told you that The world has seen totally seven pandemics. The first six pandemics were caused by the classical biotype and the seventh one by LTR biotype. Now, most of the outbreaks of cholera, wherever they are happening, are mostly from the LTR biotype. The classical is almost gone and LTR is the predominant one. In some places, they have found that there are some isolates which are neither fully classical nor fully LTR. We call them LTR variants, because they have overlapping properties of both the biotypes. So both the properties are, some are this positive, some are, some test positive for this, some are here. So it is not easy to distinguish whether it is classical or LTR. So both properties may be there. They are called LTR variants. So what are the properties of this bacterium? So I told you that they are gram-negative, comma-shaped bacilli. Look at this picture here. Even though this is a bacillus, this is slightly curved here. This slight curvature is seen here. Okay. And they have a single polar flagellum. We don't call it flagellum, we call it flagellum. Single polar flagellum. And that is why it is a very fast bacterium. Its motility is described as darting type motility. I'll come to that a little later. So this is a strictly an aerobic bacterium. It is non-fastidious, so it can grow on simple medium. It is oxidase and catalase test positive. It ferments several sugars, but important ones are glucose, sucrose, mannose, and arabinose. It does not ferment lactose, so it is a non-lactose fermenting bacteria. However, on prolonged incubation, it can ferment a little late. So it is also called as late lactose fermenter. Remember this was Viva question. An example for late lactose fermenter is Vibrio cholerae. And also remember, Vibrio cholerae is oxidase positive. Now, the genus Vibrio can be divided into those two categories, those which are halophilic and those which are non-halophilic. By halophilic, we mean requirement of salt. Which salt? Sodium chloride. Vibrio cholerae is not an halophilic bacteria. That means it can grow even without NaCl. But if you provide up to 1% NaCl, it is good for the growth. So 1.1% sodium chloride is optimal. However, it can tolerate up to 6%. It cannot tolerate more than 6%. Now, this is salt tolerance test. I'll talk about that later. I already mentioned it is susceptible to lysis by certain bacteriophages, which forms one of the conditions for biotyping. It is acid labile but is stable to alkali. So Vibrio cholerae can withstand a pH up to 8. Why is this important? This is important because we can use this pH for enrichment or for selective medium. That means when you collect feces along with Vibrio, E. coli will also be there. You don't want Vibrio, you don't want E. coli to grow. So how will you inhibit E. coli? Raise the pH up to 8. So under this alkaline condition, other bacteria such as E. coli will not grow. Only Vibrio cholerae is able to survive this pH and can grow. On blood agar, instead of hemolysis, you see something called hemodigestion. I'll show you the picture and talk about this little later. Now let us see how do we diagnose Vibrio cholerae with the help of laboratory aids. As always, we'll start with specimen collection. What is the specimen that should be collected? Freshly passed feces sample. It is collected in a wide-mouthed container. What about rectal swabs? Rectal swabs can be collected in case of convalescent patients, or you are looking whether the person has become a carrier or investigation of carrier stage. So rectal swabs only in case of convalescent patients or to detect the carrier stage. Now this bacteria will die readily. Therefore, sample must be transported immediately. If you suspect there is a delay, then you can use transport media. Which are the various transport media that can be used? They include Cariblair medium, alkaline salt transport medium, or Venkatraman Ramakrishnan medium, abbreviated as VR medium. So these are the three transport medium. Any one of them can be used in case of delay. Once the sample is received in the laboratory, what investigations are performed? First is gram staining. Gram staining may or may not be helpful. If you can see curved gram-negative bacilli, then it might indicate the presence of Vibrio cholerae. It is difficult. The next investigation that is often done is a hanging drop preparation. What is hanging drop preparation? A drop of the rice water stool is taken on a cover slip. This cover slip is inverted and is placed on a slide with a ring and observed under microscope. So this is useful only if the stool is freshly collected and is water inconsistency. Here, you will find that the Vibrio cholerae is moving around rapidly. This motility is described in three following ways: darting type motility, shooting star motility, or swarming gnats motility. Gnats are the small flies which fly very fast. So swarming gnats motility. These are the three terms used to describe the motility of Vibrio cholerae. If you add a drop of anti-serum against the flagella, this antibody is immediately arrested. So this is called motility inhibition test. So this is a very specific test to identify Vibrio cholerae. So if you are seeing an actively motile bacilli, you put an anti-drop, the motility stops, you immediately know that this is Vibrio cholerae only. Now, we can also use enrichment medium. Enrichment medium such as alkaline peptone water or monsoon tauracolate peptone water. Now, what is the importance of enrichment medium? Enrichment medium is a liquid selective medium which will serve as a backup. That means when the stool is cultured on solid media and do not yield any growth the next day, then this will serve as backup. So you can subculture from the liquid enrichment media and recover the bacteria. Now, so which are the primary plating media? Plating media means the media on which the sample is plated or inoculated. They are 1. Meconkey agar and 2. Selective media. On Meconkey agar, following overnight incubation, you will get a non-lactose fermenting colonies. If you incubate it further, it may turn into pink because it is also a late lactose fermenter. So on a Meconkey agar, you must always look for non-lactose fermenting colonies when you have cultured a stool sample from a patient, because the lactose fermenters are usually in normal flora such as E. coli or Klebsiella. So always look for non-lactose fermenting colonies. If you want to inhibit all normal flora and want to recover only the pathogen, then you have to go for selective media. The most commonest one of them all is TCBS agar, thiosulfite citrate bile salt sucrose agar. This is TCBS agar, a selective medium. Other alternatives are alkaline bile salt agar, monsoon gelatin tauracolate telluride tryptase agar, GTTTA agar. But anyway, of all of this, remember the TCBS agar. This is the one which is most commonly used. This is green in color and it contains sucrose. Because Vibrio can ferment sucrose and produce acids, it produces yellow colored colonies on TCBS agar. So on TCBS agar, you must look for yellow colored colonies. Okay. So if there is no growth on primary cultures, as I said, it should be subcultured from the enrichment broth onto the Meconkey agar and incubated for one more day. Once you get the colonies, the non-lactose fermenting colonies on Meconkey or yellow colored colonies on TCBS, you have to identify them by performing biochemical test. Catalase is positive, oxidase is positive. On TSA agar, it shows acid but by acids. This mistake here, it is acid but by acid slant without any gas or H2S. It is anaerogenic, doesn't produce any gas. It doesn't produce any H2S either. Sugar fermentation, remember I mentioned some sugars, those sugars are used. Urease test is negative, citrate test is positive, MR test is positive, and VP is variable. If you remember that, the LTOR strains biotype is VP positive and classical ones are negative, so it is variable here. This is string test positive. It is positive by Colloredo reaction and it is positive by salt tolerance test. What is string test? If you take a drop of bile solution onto the colonies and emulsify it in bile, the bile will lyse the bacteria, its DNA will come out and the whole liquid will become viscous. So if you gently raise the loop from the slide, it will form a thin string. This is known as string test. What is cholera-led reaction? To a Pepton water growth, if you add concentrated sulfuric acid, few drops of sulfuric acid, it will form a red ring at the top. This is because of production of nitrosoindole. So one test which shows it is nitrate positive as well as indole positive. So two in one test. What is salt tolerance test? You will have to use Pepton water with varying concentration of sodium chloride. You will see that Vibrio cholerae can tolerate salt up to 6%. So that is an identification of Vibrio cholerae. When grown in a liquid medium, it forms uniform turbidity with a surface pellicle. Surface pellicle is because the organism is an aerobe, and two, it produces fimbriae. So these are the two properties which shows why they form surface pellicle on liquid medium. Another property of Vibrio cholerae which distinguishes it from similar bacteria such as Plesiomonas or Aeromonas is that Vibrio cholerae is susceptible to O129 disc. So you have a disc which contains pteridine phosphate. So to that compound, Vibrio cholerae is susceptible, whereas Plesiomonas and Aeromonas are resistant. Now, once you have done the biochemical test, you think it could be Vibrio cholerae, but how do you confirm it? How do you confirm the identification of Vibrio cholerae? That is by performing slide agglutination test with O1 antiserum. So you have to take a glass slide, put a drop of saline, take the colonies, emulsify, make a suspension. To that, you add one drop of O1 antiserum and mix it. If it agglutinates, it is clear that this is an Vibrio cholerae O1. If it is negative, then repeat it with O139 antiserum, because these are the only two serogroups which causes cholera. So once you have identified the bacterium as Vibrio cholerae O1, then you have to identify which biotype is it or which serotype is it. As I already mentioned, for routine diagnosis, this may not be required. For epidemiological purpose, you may have to perform further slide agglutination test to know whether it is Inaba, Ogawa or Hikojima serotype, or perform additional biochemical tests to know whether it is classical biotype or LTOR biotype. So this is how Vibrio cholerae appears on various culture media. On Newton agar, it forms transparent colonies which may have slight bluish tinge when looked at a particular angle. On Mekongi's agar, they produce colorless colonies, which is described as non-lactose fermenting colonies. On TCBS agar, which is green in color, Vibrio cholerae produces yellow colored colonies. So on blood agar, some strains produce hemodigestion. Hemodigestion is not the same as hemolysis. Here, the metabolic products of the bacteria are bringing about a change in the RBCs, resulting in greenish discoloration. This is called hemodigestion. Monica, your audio is on. So these are the pictures of the biochemical test. This is what I meant by a hanging drop preparation. So as you can see, the drop is hanging underneath a cover slip, which is placed on a glass slide with a ring. And this is observed under the microscope to look for bacterial motility. Bacterial motility can also be detected by using semi-solid agar, as you can see in this picture. Haziness around the point of inoculation suggests that the bacterium is motile. This is the TSI showing acid but by acid slant without any gas or H2S. Indole is positive, there's a ring. Urea is not hydrolyzed, citrate is utilized, and sugar such as mannose or sucrose is fermented here. So this is what I was talking about. This is what I was referring when I said a string test. So here you have got the suspension mixed with bile, and when the loop is lifted, it forms a string. So this is a positive string test, and this is a slide agglutination test using specific antiserum. Another way of detecting Vibrio cholerae in stool sample is through rapid immunochromatography based tests. So these tests are also available, which can identify both O1 or O139 in fecal samples within few minutes. This kit has been shown to have high sensitivity, but specificity can vary anywhere between 65 to 85%. So these tests must always be followed up by culture. Now let us come to the treatment of cholera. Now, because the death or the morbidity in cholera is because of fluid loss, the first line of therapy has to be fluid replacement. If the fluid loss is either mild or moderate, then oral rehydration is sufficient, as shown in this picture. If the fluid loss is severe, then the fluid has to be replaced through intravenous infusions. Either Ringer's lactate solution or normal saline can be given. Now, what is the importance of antibiotics? Antibiotics have very little role in the treatment of cholera because antibiotics have no effect on the toxins. Cholera is because of the toxin. So antibiotics have no effect on the toxin. What antibiotics do is to hasten the clearance of organism. So whatever bacteria is present in the intestine, they are removed so that organism is removed quickly. As a result of that, it prevents the development of carrier stage. So once the bacteria in the intestine are eliminated, the person or the patient may not become a carrier. And if the bacteria are killed, then the duration of diarrhea also becomes short. So these are the three advantages of using antibiotics. So which are the antibiotics that are used? Earlier it used to be tetracycline, but now the antibiotics of choice are macrolides such as erythromycin or azithromycin. Alternate drugs include doxycycline, tetracycline, ciprofloxacin, cotrimoxazole or furazolidone. Remember that antibiotic resistance in Vibrio cholerae is also developing, and therefore antibiotic susceptibility test may be performed. Now, how do we prevent cholera? Prophylaxis. There are three modes of prophylaxis: general prophylaxis, chemoprophylaxis, and immunoprophylaxis. By general prophylaxis, we mean proper disposal of feces. Ensure that the feces doesn't contaminate water bodies which is being used for drinking purposes. Safe eating and drinking habits, which includes disinfection and treatment of drinking water, such as chlorination by the municipal authorities. Maintaining proper hand hygiene. So these are the general measures. What about chemoprophylaxis? Chemoprophylaxis is given only during an outbreak. That too, to the household contacts of patients. And the drug given here is tetracycline. What about immunoprophylaxis? Yes, we have vaccines. There are two types of vaccines: killed vaccines and live vaccines. So we have the whole cell killed vaccines and live attenuated vaccines. There are two types of killed vaccines. One is a whole cell vaccine, which contains heat killed cells of Vibrio cholerae, containing all the two serotypes, that is Ogawa and Inaba, and both the biotypes, which is classical and LDOR. Now, there is a variant of this vaccine which contains the same as the previous one, that is, it contains the heat-killed cells of Vibrio cholerae O1, Inaba and Ogawa serotypes, classical and LDOR biotypes, plus a recombinant cholera toxin B subunit. So this is also available. Now, whether it is the first one or the second one, both of these are taken as oral. They are taken orally. They are taken as two oral doses separated by 7 days. In case of children above 2 years, it is given in 3 doses. It is not recommended for children below 2 years. Its efficacy is also less. Now we come to the live vaccines. Live vaccine that is used is the most popular one is CVD-103-HGR. This is basically a mutant of Vibrio cholerae O1, which lacks the cholera toxin gene. So because even if the bacterium is ingested, it is alive, it will go to the intestine, it will multiply, it will stimulate local immunity, but since it does not produce the toxin, it doesn't harm the person. So this is administered as a single orally administered dose. So with that, I have finished my class on Vibrio cholerae. Yes.